Hello everyone, today we would be learning about laboratory diagnosis of tuberculosis. Now there are wide spectrum of diagnostic tools available for the diagnosis of tuberculosis. The ones which we would be covering today are information regarding the specimen, microscopy, culture, molecular tests, and then in the last, drug sensitivity testing. Now regarding the specimen, the sample that would be collected in case of pulmonary tuberculosis would obviously be sputum, and in case of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the sample would depend upon the site involved. As for example, CSF in case of meningitis, biopsy in case of lymph node involvement, aspirates or biopsies in case of bone or joint involvement. Now regarding the sample sputum, two samples of sputum should be collected. One should be the spot sample, that is, it is to be collected on the spot, and the other should be an early morning sample, because an early morning sample yields a higher concentration of bacilli. The sample should be at least 2 to 5 ml in quantity, and it should be preferably mucopurulent. Now before beginning the microscopy, this sample requires a prior treatment, that is digestion, which would liquefy the thick pus cells, decontamination, which would inhibit the normal flora, and concentration to increase the yield of the bacilli. And for this purpose, methods available are Petrov's method and N-acetyl L-cysteine with addition of 2% sodium hydroxide. And this way, the sample would be prepared for further process. The sample is now proceeded for sputum microscopy, wherein two methods are available. One is ZN stain and the other is fluorescent stain. Now this sputum microscopy is a simple, quick and inexpensive method. Also it is reliable and feasible. It is specific. While it is used for the diagnosis of the tuberculosis, it is also used for monitoring the patient when they are on treatment. But there are disadvantages like low sensitivity. ZN stain has a sensitivity of 10,000 bacilli per ml of sputum. Also, one of the other disadvantages is it cannot determine the viability of the bacilli. As we can see here, the ZN staining, that is the Ziehl-Nielsen staining, we can see the acid-fast bacilli against the blue background. I assume that you are all aware about the ZN stain grading, which is negative, scanty, plus 1, plus 2, and plus 3. One thing that I would like to add here is that this grading is useful for monitoring the treatment response of the patients, assessing the severity of the disease, and also assessing the infectiousness of the patient. Higher the grade, more is the infectiousness. The other staining available is fluorescent staining, wherein 0.1% oramine is used, and we can see brilliant yellow bacilli against dark background. One of the advantages of fluorescent staining over ZN staining is that it is screened faster, as it is observed in 40x. Coming on to the culture of Mycobacterium tuberculosis, it offers certain advantages over sputum microscopy. Like it is more sensitive, the detection limit is 10 to 100 viable bacilli, which is far more than we saw in the sputum microscopy. Also, it indicates viability, and a very important thing, drug susceptibility testing can be performed in culture. Culture is still considered traditionally as the gold standard method for diagnosis of tuberculosis. But the cons are it is expensive, and the very tough thing is it is time consuming. Now for culture, there are two methods available, conventional and automated. Conventional, I think you are all aware that we use LJ media for the culture of M. tuberculosis, which is an egg-based media. And the culture report with the help of conventional method comes in 6 to 8 weeks. As I earlier told you, it is time consuming. And the other method, that is the automated method, wherein the media used is a liquid media, which is called as Middlebrook 7H9, in which certain enrichment things are added, and the media is OADC enrichment media, along with an antibiotic mixture, that is Penta antibiotic mixture. And the report in automated culture comes in 3 to 4 weeks. You can see the LJ media here and the Middlebrook 7H9 here. The colonies of Mycobacterium tuberculosis on LJ media are described as rough, buff and tough, as you can see here. Also, the conventional method, as I already said, it takes approximately 6 to 8 weeks because of the slow growing nature of tubercle bacilli. We shall see the automated system in detail. One of the automated system available are BACTEC MGIT, which stands for Mycobacterium Growth Indicator Tube. It detects the growth of the mycobacteria and also drug susceptibility testing. As we can see here, the liquid culture media. The principle behind this method is this media uses an oxygen sensitive fluorescent compound which is dissolved in the broth. Initially, this large amount of the dissolved oxygen quenches the emissions from the fluorescent compound, and then later on the actively respiring microorganisms, they consume the oxygen. The quenching effect is lost, which will then allow the fluorescence to be detected by the machine. And the machine would beep the sample to be positive. The other automated system available are VersaTrack and also PacT-Alert. There are various advantages of these automated methods over conventional. One of the important advantages is it monitors the growth continuously, and it takes approximately 3 to 4 weeks for the report to come positive, as in comparison to the conventional method, which takes 6 to 8 weeks. And one of the very important advantages is it tests for drug sensitivity testing against first and second line drugs. Now, after culture, the colonies grown on the LJ media and the broth from the positively flagged automated culture are now confirmed using some tests. The first is acid fast stain, that is the ZN stain. The next is MPT64 antigen test, which is a rapid immunochromatographic test. MPT64 antigen, or 28 Dalton antigen, is highly specific for M. tuberculosis complex and negative for non-tuberculosis mycobacteria. Then there are some biochemical tests like niacin test, nitrate reduction and pyrazinamidase test, but these tests are now almost obsolete. A very important thing regarding the diagnosis of tuberculosis is that the serological methods for tuberculosis are not recommended because of its lower sensitivity, cross-reactivity with other mycobacteria, and variable antibody response against different epitopes. And hence, WHO has banned the use of serological test. The last methods are the molecular methods, which has completely changed the era of tuberculosis diagnosis. Molecular methods takes less time than culture. They are more sensitive than culture, and this is very much useful for the extrapulmonary samples, which are usually Pauci bacilli. Also, they can detect the genes coding for drug resistance, and also they are used for epidemiological typing of the strains. Right now, the methods available for diagnosis of tuberculosis are CBNAT and LPA. We shall see both of them in the next slides. Now, CBNAT, that is cartridge based nucleic acid amplification test, or also known as gene expert, is one of the strongest pillars in the laboratory diagnosis of tuberculosis now. It has got the lowest turnaround time, that is only 2 hours. Within 2 hours, you can get the report of the sample. The principle that it uses is automated real-time PCR. It detects two things. One is the Mycobacterium tuberculosis complex DNA, and the other is it detects the resistance of the drug rifampicin. The detection limit of this test is 131 bacilli per ml of sputum. But while there are pros, cons comes along, and that are, it is expensive and it cannot speciate MTB complex, that is the species identification cannot be done. I hope that you have gone through the Edpuzzle video regarding gene expert. We shall see the mechanism in short again. The patient sample washing, that is the sample preparation, is done. The next step is DNA extraction, then purification, master mix, amplification, detection, and then analysis, whether the report is positive or negative. We shall see the entire procedure of gene expert once again. First, the sample is prepared. The sample is then transferred to the cartridge. The cartridge is then inserted into the test platform. Now, inside the cartridge, the sample is automatically filtered and washed. The DNA is released with the help of ultrasonic lysis. These DNA molecules then mixes with the dry PCR reagents, and finally, with the help of real-time amplification, detection is done in the integrated reaction tube. And the output we can see in the software which is connected with this gene expert, and on the computer screen we can see whether the MTB is detected or not, and whether rifampicin resistance is detected or not. And this entire process takes around 1 hour 45 minutes. The other test available is line probe assay, that is LPA. As the name suggests, it is a probe based detection of amplified DNA in the specimen. There are LPA kits available for the process. The kits are either basic kits or the newer kits. In the basic kits, detection of MTB complex can be done, and resistant to isoniazid and rifampicin resistance is detected. While in the newer kits, species identification of MTB complex can be done. Also, resistant to second line drugs can be detected. One of the limitations of line probe assay is it can only be done on positive culture or smear positive clinical specimen. The turnaround time of line probe assay is 2 to 3 days. And there are three steps involved in the entire process. The first is DNA extraction. The second is multiplex PCR amplification with biotinylated primers. And the third is reverse hybridization. In this step, the amplicons which are generated in the earlier step are denatured into single-stranded amplicons. Then the membrane strips coated with specific probes are added, which will bind to the complementary sites of the amplified nucleic acid. Then streptavidin conjugated alkaline phosphatase is added, which will detect the hybrids of the biotin streptavidin moieties. And finally, analysis is done based on the interpretation of the line probe assay strips. Now, there are certain methods which are upcoming for the diagnosis of tuberculosis. Few of them are TrueNAT, which is a chip-based real-time PCR system, Expert Ultra, which is basically next generation gene expert, wherein the cartridge has been improvised, breath biomarkers, lipoarabinomannan antigen detection in urine and sputum, automated microscopy and image detection. Now, one of the very important things that you need to learn regarding the laboratory diagnosis of pulmonary tuberculosis is its diagnostic algorithm. Which test should be used when? We shall see the algorithm in detail. If you confront a presumptive TB patient, the first two things that are to be done are smear examination and chest X-ray. And remember, if this presumptive TB patient is a patient living with HIV, then you should directly go for CBNA, that is gene expert. Now, the presumptive TB patient is sent for smear examination and chest X-ray. If the smear is positive and the chest X-ray is suggestive of tuberculosis, then it is a microbiologically confirmed tuberculosis. If the smear is positive but the chest X-ray is not suggestive of tuberculosis, then again it is microbiologically confirmed tuberculosis because the Zn stain is positive. If the smear is negative but the chest X-ray is suggestive of tuberculosis, then you can go for CBNA. If the smear is negative or not available and chest X-ray not suggestive of TB or not available, but the clinical suspicion is high, then you can go for CBNA. Once the CBNA has been proceeded, the reports would be either MTB is detected or MTB is not detected. If MTB is detected, then rifampicin would have three options. Either rifampicin would be sensitive, resistant, or indeterminate. If rifampicin is sensitive, then the patient is sent for the treatment as per the guidelines. If it is indeterminate, then CBNA is repeated on second sample. And if again it is indeterminate on the second sample, then fresh sample is collected and sent for liquid culture or line probe assay. If the rifampicin is resistant, then patient is referred to the management of rifampicin resistant. The other option is MTB not detected. Then we shall consider alternate diagnosis and refer to a specialist. In this case, the patient could also be labeled as a clinically diagnosed tuberculosis. Also, we can go with other alternate diagnosis like liquid culture and LPA. Remember, all presumptive TB cases should be offered HIV counseling and testing. However, diagnostic workup for TB must not be delayed. For the diagnosis of latent tuberculosis, the tests available are tuberculin skin test also known as Mantoux test, which is basically a hypersensitivity reaction wherein 0.1 ml of the purified protein derivative is injected intradermally into the flexor aspect of the forearm. And then after 48 hours, the reading is taken. After 48 hours, if there is induration of more than 10 mm, then the test is considered to be positive. Remember that in adults, a positive tuberculin skin test can be used only as an epidemiological marker. Tuberculin skin test is used as a diagnostic marker only in children, wherein the positive test indicates active infection. And the other test available is interferon gamma release assay, wherein highly specific tuberculosis antigens are used and they are exposed to sensitized T lymphocytes, which are collected from the suspected individuals. This exposure will lead to the release of high level of interferon gamma from the T lymphocytes. And an ELISA format is available for quantifying this. For drug sensitivity testing, we can use Mycobacterium growth indicator tube as a phenotypic method. And the genotypic methods available are GeneXpert and LineProbe assay. Now, drug resistance is one of the most worrisome aspects for the management of tuberculosis. The resistance may occur due to primary drug resistance or acquired drug resistance. We shall see some terms regarding the resistance to antitubercular drugs. RR is the rifampicin resistance with or without resistance to other antitubercular drugs. MDR-TB is defined as resistance to isoniazid and rifampicin with or without resistance to the other first-line antitubercular drugs. And XDR-TB is MDR plus fluoroquinolone plus one injectable aminoglycoside. And as you all already know, that for the prophylaxis of tuberculosis, there is only one thing available, that is BCG vaccination. For extrapulmonary tuberculosis, the diagnostic tools available are FNAC, biopsy, cytology and smear examination in case of fluid, X-ray, USG, culture. And again, as I earlier said, serology is banned for the diagnosis of tuberculosis. You are all aware that the RNTCP has now been renamed as National Tuberculosis Elimination Program, under which the National Strategic Plan for Tuberculosis Elimination works on four aspects, that is, detect the cases, treat the cases, prevent the susceptible population, and build and strengthen the policies regarding the same. I would like to end the session with the term double trouble. That is, people having tuberculosis are at a higher risk of developing HIV and vice versa. Thank you.